810 burials here. It's got no memorial to, no stone of remembrance. Now, if you remember yesterday, I explained that there was a stone of remembrance in the cemetery at Eskenbeck. Can you recall that? Well, there isn't one here because there is one elsewhere that covers this old area. Now, what is also incorporated here is the memorial to the missing. So if you look at those screen walls out there, they contain 4,500 names that remember the missing with no known graves. Now, that is the whole of the campaign in France and Flanders in 1914. So it covers a vast area, everywhere from way over on the German border, on the Maginot Line, all the way across and south and beyond Saint-Nazaire area in the south. Indeed, of those 4,500 names on there, a good fifth of them went down on the troop ship Lancastria alone when it was sunk just outside Saint-Nazaire Harbour when it was in the process of conveying troops back home to the United Kingdom. It wasn't only up here at Dunkirk. This was the first evacuation. There was a second set of evacuations further south. That was at a later time. The cemetery out there is covered by, I'll get that put on afterwards. The cemetery outside there is covered by the Green Book. Was there anybody who had burials here? No. Right, that's the Green Book. The Green Book is in alphabetical order, and it gives all the necessary details in there of how to find a burial in this cemetery, and it also contains a map that enables you to find that burial. So that's how the system works in this book. It appears that the... Oh, there it is. There's a map included. Now, some of you have got Memorial of the Missing People to Remember. You want one? Yes? Yeah, another one. Anybody else Memorials of the Missing here? Well, this is where the Red Book comes into play. The Red Book covers the 4,500 lands that are remembered out there. Again, it is in alphabetical order, but the system that they use out there is that they are, again, in alphabetical order by regiment. Out there, your body goes into the first available plot when you enter the gates at the top there, irrespective of rank, race, creed, colour, or whatever the case may be. You could be a general, buried next to a private in principle. So out there, the rules are quite clear. The first available plot is going, but there are exceptions. The exceptions are if you were aircraft. There are those slight little differences that respect the situation in which you die. Indeed, during the Great War, when they could do it, if somebody befriended somebody else in a hospital bed and they both died close to the same time, they would try and bury them next to each other as well. The organisation that administered all this was set up soon after the Great War began, and it was then known as the Imperial War Graves Commission. But of course, this term Imperial has sort of gone out of fashion, and they had their name changed to the Commonwealth War Graves Commission in 1960. So they are the main administrative body. They look after 1.7 million burials throughout the world. 1.7 million burials throughout the world that cover both wars. Any conflict before the Great War, any conflict between the Great War, any conflict after between the Great War and the Second World War, any conflict after the Second World War, they are taken care of directly by the Ministry of Defence and under Veterans Agency now. Alright? The Charter of the Commonwealth War Graves Commission was until recently, because there have been a few changes, was until recently just the First World War and the Second War. So what happened here? The Second World War came along. After the Second World War had finished, it was decided that a cemetery would be placed here. This is technically a concentration cemetery. This is where all burials are coming. All although it's surrounded by a public cemetery, it's not, strictly speaking, a communal cemetery, this one. It's a concentration cemetery. There's plenty of space here for future burials, if they are required, from the Second World War. And what they did was, they engaged for this location an architect by the name of Hepworth. Now, Hepworth followed the tradition of the Edwin Lutyens and the Bloomfields of the Great War and designed this to be complementary with the Great War cemeteries. But he had an additional feature added here, and this is the John Hutton glass engravings. Now, John Hutton is one of the United Kingdom's celebrated glass engravers. And so he was put to task, and he researched how he was going to produce this. And so we start at the bottom here with the detritus of war that is lying on the beaches. The wrecks, you can see a wrecked small ship there. There are the Brits trying to get their comrade away. You mustn't forget the French. We've got a Frenchman here in an Adrian helmet, as you can see, just over the shoulder. They're conscious of what is above their heads. They're forming the queues which are making their way out to the small ships. They are being bombed. They are being machine gunned. You can see the machine gun in there, in the water. As you go further out, as I explained before, they're out there opposite Munro Beach, Dunkirk Beach, Coudekerque Beach, Branche Beach, Hutton Beach. There were the vessels to which the small ships were conveying the troops. You can see that there is a paddle steamer there. Also, there was numerous paddle steamers that were also over here during the evacuation. That one there could possibly be based upon the Princess Elizabeth that you saw in the harbour, which I pointed out yesterday. Now, as you go up, you can see the East Mole. Some of you walked out on the East Mole yesterday. You can see ships moored alongside. You can see the opening of the harbour entrance. Turn left 39 nautical miles to Dunkirk. Now note this smoke coming up on the left-hand side and going up and over. That depicts the smoke from the fuel tanks which the Germans bombed. And of course you have this large plume of smoke going up into the atmosphere. And finally, at the top there, you see the Luftwaffe and the RAF in action up at the very top. Note up the top there, also, you've got anti-aircraft shells bursting. Now, therein lies the problem that the RAF had. There was a lot of criticism by the khaki jobs, the army, about the guys who turned up in Air Force Blue here. Because the khaki jobs, our soldiers, were going to the RAF at, well, where are your fighter aircraft? You're leaving us over here. Where are they? Here we are, and we can't see them, and we're being machine gunned, and we're being bombed. But what happened back home was that Air Marshal Dowling, who was responsible for home defence, yes, he wanted to hold back his Spitfires, his precious Spitfires, because he knew the Battle of Britain was going to come. But the problem that he foresaw was he had to keep fighter aircraft away from the beaches. There were numerous reasons. So what he did was he set limits no closer than 3 miles to the perimeter on this side. Likewise on that side, no closer than 3 miles. No closer than 3 miles on the back end, and stay out at sea 3 miles or more. There was a reason for this. All that smoke. Who would the anti-aircraft gunners know they're firing at? If you can't see the troops on the ground, how can the anti-aircraft gunners distinguish properly whether you are an ME-109 or you are a Hurricane or one of the Spitfires that came over? So the chances are you can be shot down by your own side. So, but there was the other issue, and that is 8 machine guns on a British aircraft. Now, where are all those bullets going to find their... Sorry, 4 machine guns. Where are all those bullets going to go when you're trying to shoot down a German aircraft? If you are firing a German aircraft, and you turn at the wrong angle to try and shoot it down. Those bullets are going to go straight past that German aircraft, straight down onto the ground somewhere. So you had to make sure that you didn't fire over the beaches, because you would probably cause more death than if you stay away. So that was another reason for the RAF remaining clear of the beaches, or they should have done. Some of them did fly in simply because, as Robert Hardy depicted in the film, he had to make the choice. He saw a German bomber going in to bomb a ship, and he weighed up and he thought, I better try and shoot a German bomber down before he bombed the ship. So that was one of those occasions when the rule didn't apply, as far as the airmen were concerned. Now there's another issue that occurred here. There was an RAF pilot that was shot down over the beaches, and he bailed out. And what he did was, he made his way and joined the queue, and when he got up to the boat, he was refused entry to the boat because it was RAF. So he went to another queue and queued up. They weren't there long. So he went to another queue, he queued up there, and it got too much for him, and he pushed the boat out of the way and got on the boat anyway, because he wanted to get back home and get in another aircraft and come back over and fight. So the RAF at that time had a bit of a rough deal as far as the army was concerned, but of course they were completely forgotten a couple of months later because of the success of the battle of Britain. So anyway, this